No GMO! No GMO! No GMO! Respect their rights. We need to become one with the earth, and she will give us the Sacramento, and you follow behind these lobbyists, and you hear these lies that are just outrageous, and I think it's really important that we continue to counter them, and, you know, for instance, you hear over and over these, that science is somehow on the side of GMOs, that they were anti-science, and they actually are going around saying that there's 600 studies that are out there that are supporting the need for GMOs. And it's total crock. You know, if you go look at those 600 studies, what you find out is that most of them actually talk about the problems with GMOs. So there's no less like making it up. Unfortunately, you know, senators have too much to do to actually read the material. But, you know, to me, that's outrageous. So we need to keep talking about that. Yeah, I think I remember, I think it was Ralph Nader that talked about how we needed to get politicians to put tags on them for corporate sponsorship, sort of like we do race cars, which always struck me as a great idea. And I think we need to do exactly the same thing with scientists. We've got scientists, our scientific community has now been paid off. You know, you can't get grants for funding science unless you're going to the likes of Monsanto and Syngenta to get funding. So it's really, really difficult to be a scientist in this day and age and really speak the truth about what's happening. There are, as you know, many scientists on our side about this. The scientific community is definitely split about it, but you wouldn't know it from hearing what the lobbyists are saying at all. You would think that we're all a bunch of idiots that have no idea of science, but I think the science is definitely on our side. One of the other lies that's perpetuated over and over out there is that somehow GMOs are increasing yields for croplands. And, you know, study after study has shown that that's total BS. It's just not true. But they repeat it, like, over and over and over again, as though if they keep saying it enough times, it will be true. And, you know, the studies are actually showing the reverse. If you compare organic systems to GMO and conventional systems, the organic systems yield just as much as the GMO systems do. In fact, what they're discovering is that in drought years, the organic system suddenly performs better than the GMO. So we actually have better yields.
Don't grab the mic. It's got a short cord.
Okay, thank you. Sorry. So anyway, the lie of yields, and, you know, that to me feeds right into the other big lie, which is that somehow we need these crops to feed hungry people or to feed poor people. Or, you know, I can tell you that if you, the math of how you find out how much food costs is really simple. You take the yield, you know, and if the yield is more in an organic system, and the other side of the ledger is that organic systems take less input. So that means that there's less cost to grow organic food. So if the yields are higher and the costs are lower, you get cheaper food. It's that simple. So there is a basic lie out there, and they keep saying it over and over again, that somehow we that want to eat non-GMOs are the privileged. Other people can't afford that. That's another bunch of BS. It's just not true. We can feed more people for less money with organic agriculture than we can with GMOs, pure and simple. So we need to...
Republican candidate finished second to her. She owns has received a little more than 16,000 votes. I figure I can do this with 20,000 votes. So with your help, just press, pass the word to a few people. Just ask them to please consider voting for Mary Hermanson for Congress. And I want to bring Nancy Pelosi, ask her to come to the table and actually talk about GMO labeling and so many other issues. That, what is the leadership of the Democratic Party actually doing for working people in this country?
Hey, great.
Want to know what is in our food. And the fact that we can't know what is in our food is a failure of ours. What we need is not just chasing state and local and county laws, because those can also be challenged in court, because there's such a thing called interstate commerce. So localities can try to pass laws and spend, and we're like busy hamsters in the wheel, just getting fatigued until they just push us off. What we need is a federal law. We need to make the FDA responsible.
Yeah.
It's called the precautionary rule. It's what Europe has, because we don't know good science or bad science, but we have enough science about GMO and about atrazine to know that we don't know. That's why GMO is banned in Europe. That's why atrazine's been banned since 2004. We know enough to know that we don't know. And until we have a federal precautionary rule, a federal precautionary law, we are going to continue to chase local state laws where they will be challenged in court with their millions and millions of dollars. Now, what we've already done here in the streets and in our laws and in our propositions, win or lose, is to show that millions and millions of people want to know what's in our food. And it seems like a very simple thing to me, that if you're going to pack a potato in a fish, you have to prove that it's food before you feed that to someone's child. And before you feed something to your child, you should be able to know what's in it. So I encourage us all to do all three things. Cook locally, eat locally. Grow our own food locally. That's one thing. The other thing is to continue to support this movement in the legislation. But the other thing, the third thing that we really need to do is we need to think a bigger picture and keep our eye on the prize. Because March Against Monsanto is not about one brand. It is not about just GMO. It's about the precautionary rule and that we have a right to know what's in our food. Thank you all for being here.
Hello, my name is Bill Creighton. I'm president of the San Francisco Veterans for Peace chapter. And millions of people are still dying. Millions of people have died from the effects of Agent Orange. Monsanto was one of the developers contracted out during the war in Vietnam, along with Dow and others. We were told at the time, don't worry about it. It's just a defoliant. Weed kills weeds. And you could go on YouTube and places like that and watch people throwing drums around it and acting like it was just a weed killer. Well, it's not the case. Its effects have come so many ways, it was hard for veterans and civilians to even make a claim that was the cause of it. A friend of mine who grew up in a neighborhood, he had multiple sclerosis, most likely caused by Agent Orange, and two of his children had birth defects. And I just returned from a trip to Vietnam where we, Veterans for Peace annual tour, and part of the tour is that we work with groups of Agent Orange and we visit oranges, orphanages and hospitals. And there's a place called Friendship Village that was developed, founded, one of the initiators was a man named John Mizo, a veteran and Veteran for Peace member. Friendship Village is the similar to a residential college campus made up from adults and children all suffering from the various effects of Agent Orange. My friend Zung, who's lived there for 12 years, she's crippled, bent, difficulty moving, speech impediments, but her intellectual facilities are right on top, no damage at all. Other people will have the opposite. It manifests itself in many ways. And I'll introduce Paul Cox, who was our Agent Orange Veterans for Peace. I'd just like to say my friend Zung said to me one time after I was talking about the regrets of spraying all, and her reaction was, oh, the war's over a long time ago, and you're not spraying Agent Orange anymore. We didn't take much consultation from that because people are still dying. People are third generation now. They're still being affected. So I'd like to introduce Paul Cox from Veterans for Peace.
So basically, the same thing as
sorry, I just got here on my bike. I'm way late. I really apologize.
Paul Cox.
Yeah, my name is Paul Cox. I'm with Veterans for Peace. We're pushing a piece of legislation now that'll do a great deal to help the Vietnamese victims of Agent Orange and the children of U.S. veterans of Agent Orange. If you haven't had a chance to sign one of these orange cards, please do. The legislation was sponsored by Barbara Lee, who speaks for me.
Yeah.
But it hasn't been signed by any other Bay Area legislators. Not Speer, not Pelosi, not Thompson. None of them have. So if you live in their district, they respond to money, but they'll mostly respond, they'll respond better to their constituents. And if you live in one of those, please get in touch with us through this card, and we would help you talk to your legislator to get them support this legislation. It has five elements. Clean up the mess in Vietnam that Monsanto and Dow helped create. Help the Vietnamese victims in Vietnam. Help the children of U.S. veterans who get nothing, even though many children and grandchildren of Vietnam veterans are suffering from birth defects because of their father's exposure or their mother's exposure. The fourth element is to do some real research into the problems of dioxin, which was a byproduct of contamination in Agent Orange, made by our friends at Dow and Monsanto. And the fifth element is, help for the Vietnamese American community, which has never had, there's never been a health study of the Vietnamese American community. And it stands to reason if U.S. veterans are suffering from Agent Orange exposure, and if Vietnamese are suffering from Agent Orange exposure, there's some suffering in the Vietnamese American community also. So that's the elements of this legislation. It'll go a long way to helping the victims of the last mess.
A Native person who has been working with us on food transparency for some time, Quanah Brightman Parker. Say hello, everybody.
Good afternoon, my relatives. My name is Quanah Parker Brightman. I'm the Executive Director of United Native Americans. Just to give a brief synopsis of the organization that I represent, we were founded here in San Francisco in the Greater Bay Area in 1968. We were involved in the takeover of Alcatraz, Wounded Knees, a couple long walks across country. We led a group one time that took over Mount Rushmore, reclaimed it for my nation, the Lakota Nation. Now, my father, he's one of the founders of the movement. His name is Dr. Lehman Brightman. One of the things he used to teach when he was actively teaching at UC Berkeley, UC San Diego, and Contra Costa College in Sacramento State was these facts of the fact of, you know, Native American sovereignty. And one of the things that we're talking about here today is, of course, Monsanto. And what I'd like to bring up is these facts on what we're dealing with right now as a movement against Monsanto and some of the things we can do as average everyday people to combat what's going on. Now, a lot's been mentioned, you know, about, you know, GMO food and, of course, the numerous health effects that are affecting all of us, and specifically as far as Native American people back home on the reservation who are still living in these concentration camps that your forefathers put our people on. Now, we signed 389 treaties. Through 389 treaties, we gave up over 1 billion acres of land. Every inch of North America is stained in Indian blood. Now, here we are. We're here in front of this particular facility, the UN Plaza, and I don't see the UN doing anything for the northern tribal people as far as our sovereignty here and our claim to our ancestral lands. Over here, there's actually a statue of an Indian, you know, where they're basically looking down on him. And right here in front of UN Plaza, that's how they treat us here in North America. They ignore us. Now, I'd like to remind each and every one of you that 62% of the world's food supply came from American Indians. Corn, potatoes, and peanuts
are the three largest forms foods that we eat every day. In every meal, you're going to find these particular foods. A lot of them have been genetically modified by Monsanto, by this insidious corporation that is now controlling all of our food. Now, as far as the First Nations people and the way we see this, this is disgusting on how they have manipulated not only our lands, they are fracking our land as we speak as far as our water supply, and then that goes into directly into our food. So we're not only having these GMOs being genetically being put into our food, but we're also, when the ground is seeped through this water that is contaminated with these acids and all these things to break down the cells so that they can extract this oil, we're also ingesting that as well. Now, I'd like to bring to the attention that, you know, Senator Evans, Noreen Evans, she of course came out with this particular piece of legislation here in California, which is called SB 1381. We need everyone here, if you really want to help as far as, you know, giving it to Monsanto, fighting back, we have to do this in every state, labeling all of our GMOs in every single state until the federal government, and specifically the FDA, does something about this insidious issue that is continuing with our food supply and the poisoning of our Mother Earth, our people. And I'd like to bring to attention some of the things that are going on as far as nationally and globally. As far as us, UNA, you know, there's basically, if you lobby at the Capitol, you know, there's actually this particular piece of legislation that is right now that we must reverse. That's House Resolution 733, which is, of course, the Monsanto Protection Act. Now, one thing I'd like to see is the UN step forward and actually do something more than just push around paper. They can take a stand against Monsanto. They are powerful enough to take on Monsanto. Us, as a community, we have to continue at the grassroots level to fight every single day. I say divest in Monsanto. Boycott all their products. That's what each and every one of you, if you really want to hit them, you have to attack them in their wallet. That is the only way that we're going to combat them and defeat them in the long run. But we must continue to organize through our communities, no matter what color you are, no matter what race you are. Please make those calls to your elected leaders at the state and nationally for these particular pieces of legislation that we need. Even here, right here at City Hall, we could go to City Hall and demand that they start labeling GMOs. Can it be done? Are the organizers here ready to make that move as far as introducing that? They just put a ban on plastic bags being sold here in this city. Well, why can't they do something about GMOs? We can do these things, and we have to do these things to fight back, and to fight back peacefully, constructively. That's the way we're going to defeat Monsanto. That's the way we're going to fight back against these corporations, is continue to embrace each other and continue to organize together. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Keep it up.